Yes. My name is Miki. I'm the development director, and today I'm going to pass it on to Lauren, who will be running the interview. So whenever you're ready, Lauren.
Okay, great. Hi, everybody. I'm, as Miki said, Lauren from NhRP. I'm zooming in from Portland, Oregon, where it's very hot, so you'll see my air conditioner in the background. And our guest today is Gigi Glendinning. Gigi is a photographer and advocate who's been documenting the exploitation of elephants and other animals for over a decade. Gigi's photos of our elephant client, Happy, you've probably seen them on our social media or in one of the many news stories about her case and campaign, such as in National Geographic, Times, New York Times, many other outlets, and her photos of Happy have also been widely shared on major national network broadcasts, and they've been vital to our campaign in raising awareness of her suffering. She's also taken photos of our client Minnie in Connecticut, and today we'll be talking about her photos of our new California clients at the Fresno Chaffee Zoo. So, and just to give you a heads up about the format today, we'll be going through a slideshow that Gigi prepared. And then we'll take questions from everyone watching who wants to ask one in the chat window. So you can leave them at any time you want, and we'll check them out towards the end. So, okay, Gigi, thank you. And before we get into the slideshow, I wondered if you could talk a little bit about how you came to do this work for people who might not already know your kind of journey.
Sure. Hi, everyone. Thanks for being here. So I'm just a regular person who kind of tuned into the animals in my area, the circus that was down the road from me, and the Philadelphia Zoo. So I live about 40 minutes from Philadelphia. And when I started to really just kind of, I guess it might've been after one of my first trips to Africa, it made me want to go check out our zoo again and see what the deal was. And there was a campaign to free the elephants or move them out to a sanctuary. And at that time, we had three elephants in a quarter acre exhibit. And in this first slide, you can see Delari over in the bottom left-hand corner. She was the one Asian elephant, and then there were two African elephants. And so I joined in the campaign to educate the public about their situation. And at this time, the AZA was forcing zoos to close their exhibits if they didn't meet a minimum standard for space. And Philadelphia wasn't able to raise the money, and they didn't even have the space to increase their exhibits. So they were, you know, had to close it. And Delari, the picture, the elephant pictured here, was sent to the elephant sanctuary. And the other two elephants were kept in the system, despite incredibly misleading claims the zoo made and $500,000 they put towards building a barn for them in Pittsburgh. But that's a whole nother story. My point with putting these slides together with Happy in the upper left, Amala in the upper right, who is in one of the Fresno elephants, and Patty in the bottom right. She's also held at the Bronx Zoo separately from Happy. And so it's just to show you that pretty much all zoos have the same setup, the same depressed, bored elephants on display. I think you'd probably find the same situation at your own zoo if you have elephants there. And so I just want everybody to be aware that no zoo, or in my opinion, no zoo is able to meet the needs of an elephant. And it's been my experience that that's all I've ever seen is miserable elephants at zoos and circuses. Mm-hmm. And so I know we were waiting for what to do next with Happy, but, and Minnie, one of the circus elephants, but I just want you to know that the work that's going to be done on behalf of the Fresno elephants will benefit all elephants in captivity. That as much as you're, you know, we don't want to, you know, stop any case this Fresno case is going to just move the case forward for all of them, if I'm making any sense.
You are. And I might put it too, is that we want to share the stories of the individual elephants at the same time as we want to draw attention to the core systemic issue, their rightlessness and the whole zoo captivity, elephants being captive in zoos. So yeah, totally agree.
So we could go to the next slide. Oh wait, Courtney's muted. There you go. Okay, so here's the Fresno Zoo exhibit. And it is purposely misleading. So it's the elephant space is the back portion of what you're viewing here. But this is the public's first look at the elephant exhibit. When you walk around the corner from the other parts of the zoo, the space opens up and you're treated to this sort of African savanna impression. And it really looks like they have a nice big yard, especially when you've seen elephants at the Bronx Zoo or in Philadelphia or somewhere else. This is like, you know, what people get excited about. And so
it's pretty sad that this is a good example of proceed.
And it's understood that people, you know, when I get into discussions with people about zoos, they say, oh, but some are good. And, you know, San Diego has the safari park, and they get excited about how exhibits have evolved and changed. But really, when you start to look closely, which I invite all of you to do when you go to a facility that's got animals on display, is to just sort of look with a different lens and go in as if you're, you know, questioning what's happening versus in awe of it. And you'll soon discover that there's a lot of like smoke and mirrors going on here. And that ultimately all of these exhibits are just a cage. And these elephants, unfortunately, were stolen from the wild. These are the two females in this picture. Were taken from their family. They were literally ripped away from their family and put on a plane and brought to America to be put on display. So if you care about elephants, you should take issue with the AZA kidnapping them for breeding purposes.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people don't know that still happens, that elephants are imported to the US to live in zoos.
It does happen, and it does happen under false pretenses. The one keeper who approached me while I was photographing the elephants, because I did hang out there a long time, they came up to me and they were saying, asking, or he had described their situation that these elephants were going to be killed. And when you research the import that took place, that brought in 18 elephants, one of which died in transit, but 17 are now in U.S. zoos, you'll find there was, it wasn't what they say it was as far as an exchange or rescue. So we can get into that if you want to, but my main point about showing you this is to show you how they're trying to make this look like Africa. And so Courtney, you can go to the next slide if you want.
And Gigi, when we send around the link to this recording, we'll highlight that Charles Siebert article.
Okay, good.
Whole dark. Yeah,
that article is really great. Okay, so here's what I mean by look closely at things when you get there. And this could be anywhere. If you're just happen upon some kind of close encounter, tourist trap thing, and you feel like going in, or your kids make you go in or something, you know, just go in, but look and take photos with our kind of a lens. We'll start in the upper left. You can see as coming out of the rocks are these little, they look like little whale spouts. It's a wire stick with a spout of wires coming off of it that drape over all the rocks. It's kind of hard to see which intentionally hard to see, so people don't notice it, but it will keep the elephant from moving that boulder. And then if you look to on the upper right, you'll see a wire that looks like a vine climbing up the tree. And when you zoom in on that photo, which we can't today, but it's literally like a cord stapled, a wire stapled to the tree. And then as you go out on the branch, oh good, look at that, Courtney. You'll see the little curlicue wires there on the far right, catching the light, they're hanging down so that the elephants don't break that whole branch off, which would be fun for them to do. But then it would destroy the tree. So, you know, elephants are incredibly strong and they're gonna rip apart a habitat in one day. So to keep up this kind of illusion of Africa, they need the vegetation to stay where it is. And if we back out again to the lower corners, there we go. This is another thing that the architect of this exhibit really prides himself on inventing, is this barrier between the water holes. So the viewing public cannot see this from ground level. I took this photo from the giraffe exhibit on the far side of the elephant exhibit, which brought me way up higher above the lake. And so that barrier goes through the water, and on one side, on the left side is the access for the elephants, and on the right side is access for the rhinos. I didn't see anybody go in the water, not sure how steep of a drop that is, but the wall is there to keep them from crossing through. And so again, with the illusion that the space is meant for the elephants, it's really, it's completely divided in half, including the water. And I did read in the architect's notes that that wall is designed to lift up. So if they were to have, when they have babies at this exhibit, the baby won't be able to swim over it or maybe even get stuck in there, I don't know. And again, that other photo, if you go back to the left, is more of those spouty type wires just to keep the elephants from engaging with the vegetation and the rocks. See, there they are. That's a good photo of them. And there you can see the rhinos behind the elephants. I think zoos like to put, you know, all the African elephants together like you might see them on a safari. The day I was there, they had antelopes in with the elephants, and the antelopes, one injured another. And then they had to move the elephants off exhibit for a couple hours while they tried to help the antelope. Mm. And one of your previous guests had mentioned how the antelope are eating the grass that's there for the elephants or not there because they've already mowed it all down. And so not only do they take some of the food away from the elephants, but they took away their yard time. So... Mm.
Yard time, that sounds like prison.
Yeah, it is definitely a prison. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we can go to a prison compared to the next slide. Look at that. Now, I pulled this off of Instagram, and just because it's a great aerial to show you how much land they cover and walk, you know, 20 plus miles a day, searching out a variety of vegetation, engaging with all kinds of, you know, trees and stumps and mud and the ability to swim and socialize. I mean, we know everything we need to know about what elephants need. So the idea that we think it's okay, or we all are approving that they're kept on display, is just ridiculous. It's beyond, we're beyond this. We need to take what we've learned and end this practice. Okay, Courtney.
It'd be great to see more zoos getting zoo leadership getting on board with that, because they can be part of the change, and there have been some powerful examples.
They're in a prime position to help. And I would love to get into that again in a minute. Let me show you this, though. This is a video of how no enrichment is going to really cut it for an elephant who's used to engaging with so much stuff in Africa. And again, these two were taken from Africa. So they had, you know, at 10 plus years living a natural born life. And then they're pulled out and put here. Mm-hmm. And so here comes the baby, Amala, right? So she's like, you know, maybe they change out the stumps so that they're new and that she can maybe look at it. But watch, this just struck me as how bored she is. She finds a little stick. Just drops it. I mean,
yeah.
It's just a whole lot of nothing happening in there. And this is a good view of their grass, how it's gone. But she's a baby. She should be playing with lots of baby elephants.
Yeah. It's amazing to me that people who work in zoos think this is okay. Like, are they persuaded by their own? We can reflect on that later, but it's just amazing that literally anyone could look at this and think this is okay, even if you were part of the zoo system. But
well, and I think that zookeepers, you know, they take that, they go in that direction or into that field because they love animals. And I think people who go to zoos go because they love animals. But, and zookeepers will, you know, do everything possible to help them and stimulate them. But their hands are tied. There's just no way to meet their needs.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. Yeah. So if any zoo employees are watching this, come, we welcome you.
Yeah, I don't blame them. I mean, I'm glad they're really the only relationships these animals have. And, but I really do, after listening to your doctor on the neurological side of it, I found a lot of what he said about those relationships interesting, if I'm remembering correctly. You know, we love to think they care about us, but really, I mean, these animals want out.
Yeah.
Yeah, I believe he called it Stockholm syndrome.
That's right. It's true. And you know, it's just, if we love them the way we say we do, we would want more for them than this, period. And we should fight together, work together to make it possible. I do believe we can move all the elephants out of zoos and put them in sanctuaries, stop breeding, stop taking them from the wild, and let this be the last generation of captive elephants. But, you know, when zoos talk about conservation, they are talking about conserving a captive population for the next generation. And they're really holding tight to the notion that you have to see an animal up close to care about it. And that is simply not true. It's nice, it's cool, right? But,
Right.
Okay, we can go to the next slide. Okay, so the better option is sanctuaries. And I've been to PAWS. This is PAWS in California. I went there for one of their elephant summits and got to see the setup, and it's beautiful. The elephants have a choice to go in the barn if they want to, but they don't ever have to. They have these rolling hills, which is great for their physical strength to cross varied terrain. And then they do have a separate hillside, kind of where we're standing in this photo behind us would be where they keep the bachelor herd, their bulls, which they do have, keep them on the farther side. So this is what the territory the females have. And it's thousands of acres compared to the zoo's 3 acres. So it's not the wild, but it's better than a zoo.
Mm-hmm.
And the next slide will show, I think, is the elephant sanctuary in Tennessee, which I did go there as well. I went to volunteer for one of their weekends, which they never promise you'll see elephants. You only might see one if they come to like the fence line you're working on or the barn you're painting. I was working in an offsite hay barn, cleaning it out and everything. So I didn't see any elephants, but I did get to talk to one of the founders about the Philadelphia Zoo elephant that was moved there and asked him all about how she was adapting and the challenges she had moving from the quarter acre yard at the Philadelphia Zoo to this expansive territory. And he was great about telling me how she was adapting and learning to like walk around bushes and stuff and to find his voice and to, you know, navigate the hills with being so out of shape. And she made a best friend there, Minnie, and they would walk together. And we would, just like other elephants that are retired there or moved there, they post photos so you get to see how much better they look and how happy they are. And so she did great. And she got to die there in peace with her best friend. And, you know, that's the most we can offer them at this point. And so this is just an example of how natural of a habitat it is. And if you want to go to the next slide, I think it's another picture.
And, Gigi, before we discuss the next slide, could you talk a little bit more about like the differences between a zoo and a sanctuary in terms of that, the allowing the elephants to kind of disappear into the habitat versus what a zoo does and how that's built into the exhibit, the idea that they will be seen.
Right, yes. So sanctuaries are not open to the public. Typically, they might have a member day or something where they let the members view the animals for an hour or something. But typically they are set up for the animal only, and they have cameras. So they might have like the Tennessee sanctuary I know has elephant L cameras. So you can check in on the elephants and see where they are. They've got different ones set up throughout the property. You can watch them go about their day, but they have 100% freedom to choose what they do. They can, at the elephant sanctuary, when I was volunteering there, they would actually drive the food out to wherever the elephant was in the 2,700 acres, and they would drop the food near them and leave them be. I'm not sure now how they're doing that, if that's still the case. Like, I don't want to speak out of turn, but that was how they were doing it then. And they are separated African from Asian, so they have their little herds. And so I think when new elephants come in, like Nosy, for example, this elephant on this slide, she's quarantined and will eventually hopefully be paired up with someone she's getting along with through a fence kind of thing. But so to answer your question, they've got choices. They have a variety of habitat to explore. They have, mm-hmm. they do have vet care, and they have a barn they can go in. But a zoo, you know, you're really on a routine schedule. You're in the barn when the zoo's closed. You're on display when they're open to the public. They do have vet care. I'm sure their vet care is great. They want their elephants to, you know, thrive and survive. But with the substrate and the hard surfaces they're standing on for so many hours, they inevitably have problems, foot problems, and health issues. Musi, the big male at Fresno, had diarrhea. And when I asked the keeper about it, he said it's a chronic condition and that he has allergies, is how he put it. Did I answer that enough?
You did, thank you. And I asked in part because I was thinking of one of the photos you've taken of Happy that I find most powerful, which is the one, it's the vantage point of the monorail with the people looking down at Happy standing in the display yard. And I'm standing in front of that trough with, I don't know what's in that, but it's, the trough is, at, they want, there's all, that's all she's really got to do is eat from that trough when she's in that yard. Right. So they put it, I'm saying the obvious here, but they put it right where she'll have to stand to be seen. So that she's pretty much standing there all day at that trough. And that's why I find that photo so upsetting, because it's all for the human gaze. It's not for her.
Right. Yeah, and Zeus will cut the grass so that you see the animals where, you know, the lions and tigers, they want to hide in the grass. But of course they want everybody in the front of the exhibit, not tucked away in some cave. I mean, right. They will now, they'll create a den for them, but they'll put a glass wall in the den so you can walk into the den and see them sleeping or watch them underwater or, you know, so it is all about the viewer. Sanctuaries is no breeding, no visitors. It's just all about meeting the animal's needs, no matter what the species it is. Yeah. And in this slide, I put this here just to show you, this is Nosy, an elephant. I photographed in 2010, who was here in Oaks, PA, and this was a circus in a warehouse, windowless warehouse. And you can see there's a couple of donkeys tied to the wall too, or they might be mini ponies. And Nosy was about to give rides when a fire broke out on the other side of the building. And so they chained her by two legs to the wall and left her in the building with the horses too, and we evacuated all the people, and she was in there the entire time. The alarms were going off, and they got the fire under control, and then they actually resumed the circus. But I used this photo, was used in a court case against her owner, and he was fined. Anyway, to make a long story short, I never thought Nosy was going to get out. I have worried about this elephant since this day. And now she's at the elephant sanctuary. And it's all thanks to people like making their opinions heard. So just a groundswell of animal rights activists, of regular citizens who were just appalled by her treatment, and groups that were just relentless at fighting for her freedom. And sure enough, she has it now. And so I just wanted to put that in there as there is an answer. Mm-hmm. And if Nosy can get out, then so can Minnie. There's Minnie. Yeah, go ahead, that next slide. There's Minnie. We won't want to forget about Minnie. And again, this is why zoos are in a prime position, because there's elephants like Minnie who are in like the worst situation, alone in a dark barn, all by herself, basically dying in a dark barn, who would be happier at the Fresno Zoo. They didn't need to steal elephants from the wild. They could have brought Minnie there. The sanctuary is the ideal spot, but the point being that the animals need our help, and zoos can be a part of that solution. So this chart is one that the Philadelphia campaign used or had made, a friend of mine had made, and it just shows the difference. It's just a good visual for people trying to educate others. The Philadelphia Zoo was 42 acres, so the little black dot. The elephant sanctuary where Delari was moved is 2,700 acres. And in the wild, this was an estimate green circle of their territory or their range in the wild. So it's just this is all for everybody listening to just kind of keep in mind, keep in your, when you're trying to talk to people and have, promote critical thinking on the issues, just stick to the facts and kind of give people perspective of the options out there.
Yeah.
Courtney.
Thanks, Courtney.
Thanks. Oh, and this is our last slide already. So there's the three Fresno elephants. And, you know, I just, like we were saying, they're in the prime position to help. We could get these guys to a sanctuary right away. And rather than breeding them and having more babies in Fresno, just move these three out before they become, you know, damaged from being confined.
Yeah. And thank you. And correct me if I'm wrong here, but the zoo has gone on record, and I think someone, an employee, told you they do plan to breed Musi with the other elephants, with Amale and
yes,
Nawazi. Yeah. Who are with both of them.
With both of them. And I said, does that mean at any given moment? And he said, yes. Mm-hmm. And I didn't, you know, want to say, ask if they were going to use artificial insemination. I was trying to just, you know, behave like a normal tourist and not get into it with him. But he said, yes, Musi is free to mate either one of them at any given time.
Mm-hmm. Right. Disturbing. We'll have to do another Zoom seminar on what forced breeding, you know, why that's so problematic. Okay. And actually we're right on schedule because we're going to take questions in a little bit.
Okay, super.
Yeah. So if people want to drop comments in the chat window, and I think we'll be pulling them from social media as well. There's our faces again. thanks Courtney for running the slideshow.
Thank you.
Yeah. Before we switch to questions from viewers, I wanted to ask what would you say is the primary, what would you want to be the primary takeaway from the slideshow in terms of what life is like for these elephants in Fresno?
Well, I think that it's cruel and unnecessary. They're bored.
Yeah.
They're just bored. I mean, you know, as fancy as things looked, with the holes in the wall for them to grab food, with they could walk to the water, walk to the other side, walk back. That's all they're doing, walking there. Musi had some weird leg thing. I would love an expert to weigh in on where while he was eating, he would kick one leg back and then it would be the other leg back. And so it looked like a stereotypic behavior. Not one I'd ever seen before, but I think every captive animal has their unique way of coping with their confinement. And I imagine all three of them sway when they're locked in the barn, but while they were out during the day and grazing, you know, walking around, searching the different enrichment holes, the only thing I really tuned into was Musi's weird foot thing. So whether he's got arthritis starting and it's a way to relieve the pain, or it's a stereotypic, I don't know. But my takeaway is that this zoo is not meeting the needs of these elephants, and no zoo can.
Yeah, and thank you for helping us show that with your always powerful photos and videos and insight. And I have one more question, and then I'll start pulling from the comments. But it's sort of an intense question, but as a photographer and an advocate, you've made it a choice to look toward the suffering of these elephants and other animals. Most people, I think, look away in ways that are understandable given the culture where we're, you know, it's easy to look away from human suffering as well. But so I wondered how you do that, or if you have any advice for coping with that, or it seems like it's also important to you to maintain hope, like with Nosy. And, you know, there's examples of positive change, and we're totally with you on that. So, yeah. Do you have any thoughts in that regard?
Well, I wanted to get involved. I've done a bunch of volunteer trips and things just because they interest me and I was curious. And then I did do quite a bit of humane education in schools. And so I would seek out certain stories I could tell to give people hope and get people involved. because it does come down to education. And I think that people need to just sort of step back and take a closer look at things, use some common sense, listen to people about why, you know, so many people like to tell me why they think it's important to see an animal up close. And so rather than get emotional and defensive, I like to listen to where they're coming from and kind of, you know, help them connect the dots with what I've seen, and by just giving local examples or, so for me, the photography really was just a very effective way of telling stories, and people respond to pictures. Now, the trick is to get a, take a picture so that you don't look away, but that you're like, what's going on here? And you look further versus, oh, I can't see, don't show me, I don't want to know. You know, it is, there's a fine line in between, you know, even with documentaries or anything, where people are going to shut down and turn it off, or they're going to stay with it and really take away something. And so for me, the photography is my way of, you know, I like to see it so I can explain it. And then I feel like when I meet with representatives and I'm trying to tell them why this circus or something is so bad, I have examples, very specific things like this elephant was here, here's her history of escaping, here's the fence that you have to keep her in place, and this is why it's not going to work. And then it's, you know, when they see the facts, they're more, it's not really a matter of convincing them. They're like, oh man, you're right. Or you show them pictures of Minnie here with, you know, six kids on her back and people petting her trunk, and then tell them that she's injured 8 people, like seriously injured them. They're like, oh, wait, what? And so, you know, not everybody's gonna do the homework. And for me, the animal issues are what I'm willing to do research on and I'm interested in. And for all the other major issues that people take up, I hope, you know, I trust their homework they're doing. And so I think the pictures really speak the truth and bring people in to support campaigns like yours.
Yeah, when we've seen that, as I said, with the work you've donated to us, so thank you. And can I ask too, were you a photographer before you became an animal advocate, or did you learn it to be a better animal?
I learned it, and then I needed to get some lessons and go to school for it, because my main thing was circuses. And when you're in a dark circus tent and you're not supposed to have a camera with you, you really have to like shoot from the hip. And I would find like trapeze lines with getting in my way, and the camera would focus on that and not on the animal, or I'd miss a shot, or it'd be too dark. And so I had to learn how to set the camera so that it, you know, I'd get the good image. And, you know, there's so many amazing photographers that I follow on Instagram. If anybody wants to look at who I follow, you'll find a whole slew of amazing photographers that are telling incredible stories, you know, trying to get help for animals. So they've been the inspiration. For sure.
We're gonna send out your Instagram handle, and maybe we can send out your top 3 favorite.
Okay, that's fun.
Yeah. Great. Thank you for your patience with my questions. Let me see what we've got going on in the chat here.
I have one.
Oh yeah, go ahead.
Sorry, Lauren. I have one question that came through on social media, which I thought was really good. So they ask, I read that the elephant exhibit is near a railway. Did you see it? And could you hear the trains?
I'm so glad you brought that up. I forgot. Yeah, all of these zoos are usually centered in a city, right? That's one of the things people do when they come to town. They go to the local zoo with their kids, and which means they're all right near a freeway. And this one, oh my God, the train goes by. It went by at least 4 times during the day. And it's right behind their barn. I mean, like, we have really good photos of how close it is. I should have put one in the slideshow, but it is just runs right behind their barn. And it's a freight train, so it's extra loud and extra long. And then the other thing that the Fresno Zoo elephants have to listen to all day long is a big dinosaur exhibit. So in the space that you would maybe put animals, they have gigantic life-size electronic dinosaurs that make noises like Chewbacca all day. When I first showed up at the zoo, I was like, what is that? Is that a lion, you know? And then I finally realized it was this one dinosaur head just going, over and over and over and over again. And so that, you know, it's driving me crazy. The one day I'm there and they're all so sensitive. I'm sure that's a source of frustration for them.
Mm-hmm.
Not to mention, there's an exhibit with nothing live. Like, if you can do it, why are you even having, you know, it's like the Lego exhibits they do now and the light shows that zoos put on. Like, go for it. Do all that stuff. Don't put live animals in a box.
Right. Mickey, are there any other social questions right now before I turn to the chat?
Oh, no, go for it.
Okay. So first, I hope I'm saying her name right. Tamara said, Gigi, you probably see this, but your images are wonderful and it's so helpful to see all this close up and thank you. Wanted to share. Jill asks, what's the best way for ordinary folks like me to help? Donate money to NhRP, of course, but is there anything more tangible? So there's perhaps a Gigi way to answer that and an NhRP way, I don't know. But so like, for example, I mean, Gigi, like you were talking about people going to visit zoos or if they find themselves in a situation where they're kind of compelled to, you know, for whatever reason, like perhaps you could reiterate like what is helpful about that, like being the witness, like what,
yeah. Well, what's and also,
with that once you have it, the right. Info. Yeah.
So I, you know, the easiest way to get involved, at least in my opinion, is to figure out what's happening around you. You know, I find tune in to what's going on with exotic animals, in particular elephants, near you, and then just start researching it and finding out what the deal is, because there's probably already a campaign to help them. And so you can support any local efforts is brilliant. And also, like I was saying, you know, when your friends are saying, oh yeah, we're gonna go to the zoo today, you know, call them out on it a little bit in a nice, I don't like to confront people, but I think the more we can promote critical thinking about zoos, the more we'll have, you know, people understanding the reality of what they're supporting. Remind them that they're still taking elephants from the wild, remind them, you know, of the stereotypic behavior, or suggest that they look for stereotypic behavior. I mean, you'll see giraffes licking the walls, you'll see cheetahs pacing, you'll see, like, you know, one of the things, when we were educate outside the Philadelphia Zoo, people didn't stop at our table on the way in, they were on the way out. And so even one sentence to a friend who's about to go to the zoo will promote enough thought that when they're in the zoo, they're going to sort of think of you and think about what's going on slightly differently and view it a different way. And it might be the last time they go. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so many people say to me, oh, I thought of you when I saw this show, or I thought of you when I saw this guy with a, you know, monkey. And but really what they're thinking of is the animal. They might think, what would Gigi say if she saw this? But really, they're taking a minute to think about the animal. And so I think if we can all do our part in shifting people's lens a little bit, would be good. Because it's pretty common sense. Yeah. And always stay calm. Don't get all argumentative, because that doesn't do, you know, the animals any good.
Right. You mean like in conversations with strangers and friends and
family? Yeah. Yeah, try to take the stay calm and just get your points out there and listen to what they have to say and talk, you know, don't yell in, like, you know.
Right, because it shuts people down.
Yeah, and it just doesn't look good. It's not a good look.
Yeah,
we agree. It's not a good look to get all fired up. You know, you're trying to make a point for the animals. You know, stay calm, use the facts, don't exaggerate. just get people to think about it and do their own homework. And
right. And in a different way, I guess that's what our litigation is about too. While we want it to be clear how, you know, how elephants suffer, like we want the judges to feel that like on a deep level, but the basis is the facts, the inarguable scientific facts and what we just know from human experience. And so far in our cases, that has gone uncontested. No one's ever challenged that science. It's more a matter of like, okay, here's what we know. What are we going to do about it? Right. And the zoos say we're going to stick with exactly what we're doing until the elephants die in our exhibits or we get a new one. So anyway, just reinforcing what you said there about how there's a power in sticking to those facts.
Totally. And then to answer Jill's question too was, you know, donate to non-human rights projects and other groups who are affecting change, but also, and also to sanctuaries who are picking up the pieces basically, you know, with lifelong care of elephants like Nosy. And then also the work being done in country. There's plenty of programs in Africa and in Asia that directly benefit conservation. And so you just do your homework and get your support to the right place, you know, versus the autopilot, like I'm gonna donate mm-hmm. to the zoo.
Right.
A lot of animal lovers and people who wanna help with conservation, they think that's the place to go.
Mm-hmm. Totally agree. And I'll add too that like for the Fresno campaign specifically, like what people can do, like donations help us grow the grassroots campaign. So, you know, the more you donate right now, the bigger we can make that, the more robust we can make that part of it while the litigation unfolds. It helps pay for the cost of litigation as well. But then alongside that though, at this early stage, especially sharing the elephant stories, especially if you know people in California or in Fresno too, obviously, helping them become aware of what's happening there and what's problematic about it is super helpful. If any news stories emerge, share those, comment on those. And I was gonna save this for the end, but freethefresnoelephants.com is our hub for taking action on behalf of these particular clients, just as freehappy.com is the hub for Happy. So we have action items on that page. And then we have a slideshow including some of Gigi's photos that help us show different aspects of their histories and lives in captivity and what it could be in a sanctuary. So yeah, much more to say on that topic of how to help, but those are the basics, I think. And Mickey dropped the link in the chat, I see.
Yeah, and I also have another question from social. So they ask, when you were there, were the elephants in the yacht the entire time, or did they seem to spend a lot of their time in the barn?
I was there on a weekend, and so they were out. The zoo opened at 9 a.m. and they were out, all three of them. And then they were brought in at lunch hour from like 12 to 1 and then brought back out. So I'm not sure what they were doing inside. And then on the second day, same thing, they were out in the morning and then they were brought in because of the antelope getting injured. And then I didn't, and that was around 11:30, and then I didn't, or 12, and I didn't see them the rest of the afternoon. So I don't know what happened to the antelope. It was limping, but it was taking longer to care for it, so.
And just a follow-up question from that, when they were out, what kind of, like, did they interact with each other, or like what were they doing? Yeah, how are they relating to each other, and were they also interacting with those that were working at the zoo that day?
That's a good question. Okay, so Musi was definitely covering the most territory, walking alone around the habitat or enclosure. And then the other two, the mom and daughter, they stayed together and went from station to station. So I think the elephants have their own little like lap they make, and it wasn't with each other, but they would go from the holes in the wall over here and get the hay, and then they would go over to the, they had hay that was sticking in these little metal grates out of the rocks, and then they also hung hay from trees, so they would reach, I guess, and they would, they all did that. So they were basically rotating from where they knew the food was. And I saw a couple exchanges with Musi and Amala, where he pushed into Amala in a not aggressive way. It was, I couldn't tell if it was what it was. It wasn't aggressive, but it was just a hello and then walked apart. And same with when they walked across this way once, they did a little hello and then kept going. And you know, they were, there's no way not to be near each other. They're so small. So they were all around each other the whole time. So I think they get along. I didn't see any like aggression.
Sure. And what about interaction with the zookeepers?
Oh, right. I did see the zookeepers come out at one point, and that was because of the antelope. And so they moved the elephants in. I didn't see any interaction with them directly. The elephants did what they knew to do when they opened the gates. And then the keepers came out into the enclosure and refilled all the enrichment, while two other keepers were trying to medicate the antelope or do something with the antelope. So no, I never saw any training session or anything with direct contact with the keepers. And then one keeper, the one young man who works there, came out to talk to me. I don't know if he was suspicious of my staying in the exhibit so long or what, but we had a, normal exchange that he might have with any of the tourists. And I saw him talk to some kids and stuff too.
Gigi, have you ever been recognized? Like, and they ever tried, has the zoo or circus ever tried to prevent you from entering because they know your face? Just curious.
Not at a zoo, now they might. they could easily find me if they clicked on the, but no, the circus, my last circus was the Thanksgiving before, when COVID hit. I was in Indiana at a circus they have on Thanksgiving, and I ended up in a hallway with all the worst elephant trainers, all the Friscos, and I didn't even mean to be in that hall. I was leaving the circus thinking it was over and was going to check to see where they were keeping the bears because I hadn't figured that out yet. And so I was going out the press exit. I did get a press pass to be there, so I was legit allowed. And I got stuck in a hallway with the scariest keepers and six elephants, and it was way too close for comfort. So when they figured out I was there,
that you were media,
that was not good. What,
when you mean when they figured out that you as a photographer like were there,
that I was sitting, I tucked myself into this little eddy in the wall, and it sounds crazy, but I didn't want to be that close to the elephants either. It was a very small cinder block hallway. They were saddling them up for rides after the circus, which was something I did not expect them to do. And so there they all are, all the elephants, really like 1 second away from me and lined up getting saddled. And they're all poking them with their bull hooks and making them kneel down to get the saddle on. And it's just a very tight space. And so I just filmed the whole thing and kept my head down. I had a baseball hat. I just did one of these, like tried not to move. And then when it was over, I thought, I got to get one more shot. And so I held my camera up and did one of these to get the whole scene. And sure enough, Omar, who's a trainer I've seen a gazillion times, who's was so rough on an elephant here in Philly, he went right to the head trainer, Tim Frisco, and he's like, pointed me out, and that he came over like, what are you doing back here? And I just did one of these, put my camera away, like, don't break my camera. Yeah. And thankfully a Shriner came to my rescue and said, she's cool, she's allowed to be here. And I literally held his hand. It was this gigantic, like, bouncer type guy. I was like, I'm gonna hold your hand and walk out with you, because that Tim Frisco scares me. Tim Frisco on YouTube and see why I was scared. He beat elephants.
Well, you're very resilient, brave, a whole slew of adjectives I could throw at you, but just to commend you for the work you do, because I'm sure it's not easy and you're very good at it. And we are so appreciative of you. Thank you. And I love is that elephants on your shirt? Let me see.
All of them, African animals.
Okay, great.
Just today, for the day. And all the rescue lions behind me.
Oh, fantastic.
Rescued circus lions.
So we're going to wrap up now, but before we do, I'm pulling up my phone because I want to get the link right. You can learn more about Gigi's work, which isn't limited to photography. She does these amazing collages of companion animals and other things. You can check out on her website, which is graphicrabbit.photography. Do I have that right, Gigi?
Yep.
Okay, we'll send that link out to you. And we'll send out a link to your Instagram if you like. If people want to get involved in our Free the Fresno Elephants campaign, you can go to freethefresnoelephants.com to learn more and take action. So yes, thank you. Mickey, do you have any final words, or Gigi?
No, thank you for being here though and listening.
Yeah, thank you so much, everyone. This is the final installment of our Free the Fresno Elephants interview series. So thank you everyone for joining. Thank you, Gigi. Thank you, Lauren.
Yes.
Thank you, everyone. Well,
maybe we'll have more someday in the future. So round two.
Yes. Looking forward to it. Well, thank you, everyone.
Thanks.
Bye.